Good morning, everybody, and of course, it's also an honor for me to present before such distinct audience the issue of labor market segmentation, which is a very serious drag on long-term employment. I would segregate my short intervention in two parts. First part, I try to give you an overview of what is the situation in the labor market in the context of segmentation in the European Union, a small overview. After I come to a very, let's say, simple model simulation with our labor market model, where I try to find out what could be the macroeconomic impact of EPL, lowering EPL. Okay, I start with a very brief overview, and I've decided to show you a map in the beginning. This is the unemployment rates. The darker the color in this map, the higher is the unemployment rate. You see the situation before the crisis, and what happened in the crisis strikes me very much. Not only have we seen a substantial increase in overall unemployment, but we have also seen a huge divergence. Countries like Spain, south of Italy, Greece, the peripheral countries, have seen a literal explosion of unemployment, whereas in countries like Germany fare even better. If you compare the two pictures, it's almost the reverse. So what is supposed to converge is in fact drifting apart. This is really, really striking in our opinion. And we have to find the roots of the problem. In relation to what we talk about today, we have the issue of temporary employment, one of the characteristics of segmented labor market is that they have a high share of temporary workers. We have seen that before the crisis started, specifically in the countries which had seen a high employment growth, that this larger part of the employment growth was on temporary contracts. And now the crisis comes in 2008 and strikes back like a boomerang, so to say, because we see that the adjustment to the cyclical downturn that the crisis brings in some countries goes heavily at the expense of temporary contracts. If you look that in countries like Greece or Spain, have in those five years. Lost almost 30-40% of the temporary employment, then this is a clear sign for heavily segmented labor market. Poland belongs also to the countries which has seen a huge increase of temporary contracts, which has come to a halt after the crisis or over the crisis. A halt means that we have more hirings in the temporary field, but also more firings. So the situation before and after the crisis is pretty different here. The third thing which strikes me when talking about the long-term impact of unemployment is that obviously since the crisis started, we see again a strong increase of the structural component. Unemployment becomes more and more structural of nature. There are lots of indicators which show that. One indicator is the share of long-term unemployment, in which we approach already in Europe, the 50%. It means that of all these 10-11% unemployed people, almost half is unemployed for more than a year. And this is really, it could turn out to become a time bomb unless we really tackle the situation over structural reforms. Another indicator, which I don't show here, is the beverage curve. And the beverage curve points at mismatches, labor market mismatches, which means that over the crisis, we have seen that the beverage curve turns northeast, which means that we have at the same time vacancies and unemployment. And then you can say, what a waste, what a waste. We have companies, searching for staff, but because there's a huge mismatch, these many people don't find a job. So structural reforms are urgently necessary. I will not talk about mismatches today. I will also not talk about demographics. I mean, it's clear that in times of workforce shrinkage, in which we are now turning, we cannot afford to leave one third of the workforce out of employment. I mean, we have an employment rate in Europe around 70%, not even 70%. We are way below our target of 75% that we have put ourselves for 2020. Which means that we're talking about 100 million people that for the moment are out of employment, which is a huge, huge waste of human resources. And of course, we need to fight the problem of labor market segmentation, to which I come now. I mean, to become more descriptive first, I want to find where are the member states at the moment, around 2012. So what I try here is to find a typology of member states in terms of their general labor market situation, which includes the dimension of segmentation. And what you do in these cases, if you use a lot of data, sources of more than 30 labor market indicators, but without having to present all those data, you use a factor analysis, trying to use the correlation of this data and to squeeze down the 30 factors to only a few main dimensions without having to explain what it is all about, as I tell you while showing the data. Two of the three factors that I, let's say, the main dimensions of labor market situation, which I extract in this way, are showing in this chart. The x-axis shows a factor which I call strong labor market performance, which correlates strongly on high employment rates, on low unemployment rate, high youth employment, high older workers employment rate, strong employment growth, and also strong lifelong learning involvement, a long working life. All these virtues that nowadays make a successful labor market outcome. And here you see on the right hand side the usual suspects like the Nordic countries, the Netherlands, and on the left hand side countries which have problems on the labor market for the time being. On the y-axis there is another factor being extracted, which I call segmentation, because this factor correlates very strongly on high share of temporary employment. Temporary employment is also involuntary temporary employment, and it's also strongly correlating on a high share of low-skilled workers, of migrant workers, all these groups which are at higher risk of being excluded from the labor market. This factor I call segmentation, and here you see on the very top of the scale, the southern countries, Italy, Greece, Spain, Portugal, which is a strong indication that it is very high. These countries are very strongly segmented. And if you wonder why the machine gives you for Portugal, Spain, and Greece another cluster than for the other southern countries, then you look at the third dimension that is extracted this way, and this I call on the x-axis adequacy problem, high inequality, because it strongly correlates with in-work poverty, all kinds of inequalities in the earnings, inequality in general incomes, and low wage dynamics, the low ULC, unit labor cost dynamics, in the 3 years before the crisis means mainly wage dynamics, because the countries which perform, which are on the high end of the scale on the right-hand side, like Portugal, Spain, and Greece, their unit labor costs development has been low, mainly because of wage moderation, not so much because of productivity. So here again, Poland is somewhere in the middle. It is on the segmentation part on the upper curve, on the upper half of the chart, which means that Poland is affected by labor market segmentation above average. Just to know, to let you know where member states for the moment are in terms of labor market segmentation and the general labor market situation. Talking about wages today and tomorrow, what we have done already some time ago, and unfortunately I didn't have the time to update the data, is we tried to calculate based on the Structure of Earnings Survey 2006 a wage penalty on temporary contracts. We try to answer the question, is there, after controlling for personal characteristics like education, occupation, age, gender, after controlling for personal characteristics, is there a systematically higher hourly wage for temporary workers, for non-temporary workers, for regular workers, than for temporary workers? And we see, within the exception of Greece, which is a strange result, that there is a strong wage penalty, a systematically lower hourly wage level associated to temporary employment, and the wage penalty Europe-wide is somewhere around 14%. I think it's quite interesting to see this. And now I'm finally, I try to give you an implication, give you a hint, what could be the role of EPL in improving or changing the labor market situation in the member states of Europe, and I concentrate on Poland, and I use our labor market model that we have been using since 2009 in our department, which has a very strong focus on the labor market institutions, to simulate a relative change of EPL on the basic magnitudes of the labor market, wages, employment, also GDP and output. Now EPL and the share of temporary contracts, I mean, is there a correlation? No, at least there is no obvious correlation. You see that you cannot really say that those countries which have a high protection on temporary contracts are also those with a high share of all employees, at least not in this two-dimensional correlation. So the question is now, what happens when we change EPL? What is the labor market? How does the labor market react? And I use for our labor market model simulation the country of Poland as an example, for obvious reasons. And what I assume is that I reduce the employment protection legislation index, the employment protection legislation in Poland, down to the Danish level. It sounds complicated in detail, but what we're doing here is in fact not so very complicated. Tell you later, but first of all, the model has distinguishes normally three different kinds of firing costs, which have been also mentioned by my speaker before, which is the one is the severance payment. A second very, very decisive argument, a very decisive cost of firing is administrative costs, which includes procedures that you have to follow by legislation, which also includes possible lawsuits in the unfortunate event of a split. The third, which I didn't put here, the third ingredient that the model supports is firing taxes, but to our knowledge, firing taxes play only a minor role, at least in the European countries, so that we don't include it here in this simulation. We reduce the EPL by 23%, which is already problematic because, as everybody knows, EPL is a synthetic indicator, and we apply a relative change, which one might discuss. And why 23%? Because 23% is, in principle, the difference between the Danish EPL and the Polish EPL. In the first column, you see the OECD index, the third version of the OECD overall employment protection legislation index. The original OECD one, we change it slightly because OECD does not weigh with a share of temporary and permanent contracts. We apply a weight to temporary and permanent contracts, so we arrive to slightly different weighted average index. And here you can see that there's a 23% difference between the Polish and the Danish example. Denmark is one of the famous flexicurity countries, which is renowned for quite relaxed employment protection legislation. So what we do is we take Poland as an example, we reduce EPL and we look what happens in terms of employment and wages and the labor market magnitudes of greatest interest. Before I come into the model results, maybe it's important to understand that an employment relationship between an employee and an employer at a firm is generating a certain welfare surplus for the two, which then is distributed to the two by wage bargaining. So the higher the wage bargaining power of employers, the more of this common surplus, the generated surplus, goes to the employers, and the more the wage bargaining power is at employee side, the more of this general surplus goes to the employee. So now if there is a firing cost, particularly administrative costs, what is the case with firing costs is that is a genuine waste to this relationship, because it destroys part of the rent of this employer-employee relationship, the part of the added value generated by this employer-employee relationship. You have to imagine it is an invisible hand taking part of the yield away from this relationship, from this original additional production. So to the extent that somebody reduces these costs by lowering EPL, for example, there will be an additional job surplus, because it relieves both parties from being taken away these costs. And what you have to see is that these costs are anticipated, which has been nicely pointed out by the speaker before, are anticipated by employees and employer before the contract starts and in the wage bargaining process. So if the government reduces EPL, what happens is that the job surplus of an employment relationship, the added value, increases. And this added value increases gives room in the wage bargaining process, first of all, to higher wages, which can be given to the employee, which means that part of this additional surplus is being given to the employee. Higher wages lead to higher labor market participation, and in such ceteris paribus lead to higher employment. On the other hand, this job surplus generated to the employer, to the firm, increases the firm's rent to the extent it's not given to the employee over the wages, increases the firm's rent, and a higher rent improves the inclination of firms to ask for more labor, to generate higher labor demand, which also leads to higher employment. On the other side, the more direct impact of reducing firing costs is, of course, that firing become easier. So there will be more job separations, and there will be a higher flow into unemployment, frictional unemployment in that case, which in the long run will lower employment. So we have two effects, which are counterweight to each other. Now the result is that if you do this, EPL reduction in Poland, this chart shows the long-term impact after, from one steady state to another steady state, very long-term. So it shows that wages are pronouncedly increased, which is the wage effect, which I have mentioned before. You have to can imagine that to some extent, if the employer gets relieved by a lower EPL, the margin to redistribute to be less strong bargaining on lower wages is lower, so the employer may be willing to pay higher wages because of this relief. We have this wage effect. Then what we see on the employment side is that obviously, at least in the parameters I have chosen, the negative employment impact, this lower employment part from job separation is a bit stronger than this positive impact of a higher labor demand and labor supply. We also see, if you look down, that the unemployment rate is increasing. This is the frictional unemployment of people having to search for a new job. And due to the wage increase, we have a slightly increased hours worked. So every worker on average is working offering a bit more hours to the market because attracted by higher wages, and output is declining, maybe mainly because of the employment decline. And interestingly, GDP is increasing, and the difference between output and GDP is this welfare loss, this resource cost. Yeah. GDP takes on board the output is just the product of the production function, the result of the production function, whereas GDP takes into account that this production is now being used at lower cost, at lower resource cost. So the difference between the impact, we can in fact reduce output and increase GDP because of this welfare gain that we have generated. Skills is a big determinator in this model. The model has age groups and skilled groups. And what you can see here is that lowering EPL in Poland increases the wages of low-skilled workers much more than it increases the wages of high-skilled workers. And this is, of course, reflecting that the probability of low-skilled workers is much higher to be fired than the probability of high-skilled workers, so that the impact on low-skilled contracts obviously magnified. So given the reduction of, which means that the given reduction of firing costs helps the low-skilled workers more than it helps the high-skilled workers, so that this increase of frictional unemployment for the low-skilled is less strong than it is for the high-skilled. And for the age, it's quite similar. Of course, young people are, the risk of being fired for young people is much higher than for older workers, so that the impact is also on the positive labor market impact of a given decrease of firing costs for young workers is stronger than for older workers, and older workers are much more protected, and once they are fired, they have much more problems to regain a new, to find a new job. Now, to come already to my conclusion, I cannot take it for granted that the long-term impact of unemployment, of lowering EPL, is indeed negative. It depends on a lot of assumptions that I have made in this model. But you can probably not assume that there are strong overall employment gains from lowering EPL, but you have to see the structure. You have to see that the higher frictional unemployment reflects a stronger job turnover. The job hirings and the job firings are accelerated in this scenario. So normally this is a typical situation which helps long-term unemployed. I leave it here and look forward to discussions. Thank you.
Thank you.